Morning, everyone, and I'd like to welcome you to the Long Range Planning Committee meeting for July the 12th, 2024. Our first item this morning is roll call and identifying voting members.
All right, Alan Paul.
Here.
Rick Shanae.
Here.
Peter Freilinger.
Here.
Robin Saunders.
Here.
Portia Hirschman. She let me know she won't be here. So we have, those are your four voting, and then we have Robert Odlin.
Here.
Judith Fisher, planning board liaison Rachel Hendrickson.
Here.
Council liaisons G. Mary Katarina, she won't be here. John Anderson, I don't know about that.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is to review the minutes of June the 14th, 2024.
Actually, I think we are elevating Mr. Ozzie to being a voting member for today.
We have.
You have four.
We have four here.
Yeah, so he would only be voting on the minutes, and he has not been here. So I think he would abstain from those.
Okay, gotcha. Fair enough.
Yep. Any comments on the minutes?
Move to approve.
We have a motion to approve. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a second. Thank you, Rick. Again, any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? I show that to be unanimous. Next item is to continue review and discussion and the discussion concerning existing parking standards. And I will turn it over to Autumn.
Sure. Yeah, so we don't actually have anything to vote on this meeting, so it's a good discussion. We've been having discussion about parking standards and what we want to do with those. I will share my screen in your packet. We talked about last time putting together this matrix, if you will, of villages and zoning and what's allowed, so we can really talk about that. And then I also have included in your packet, and it's very timely, the state is working on low impact development design standards for MS4 communities. There are 30 in the state. We are one of those. And one of the proposals has to do with parking. So I thought it would be interesting if we could review that and weigh in on that for our staff review.
What's MS4?
It's the stormwater program that we're part of. So we have to do annual reporting. We have specific requirements for all development.
You said there's 34 in the state?
There's 30.
30 is up along the coast?
They're all over. Robin's probably a better expert.
So MS4 is Municipal Separate Storm Sewer System. That is a NPDES permit that's required for municipalities within urbanized areas that are mapped throughout the state, which is based on Census Bureau data. And they, and because these communities have a higher concentration of stormwater, let's call it non-stormwater, that goes into your storm drains, they have a higher level of responsibility to manage what's discharged out the effluent pipes.
So it's a density issue, a population per capita, or is it just
density? It's based on density, but there are six tenets to it. We want to educate the public. We want to do outreach. We want to try to elevate construction and post-construction requirements. And I think there's two more. One has to do with how the town manages their operations and maintenance. But Angela, the town engineer, and Jamie, the sustainability coordinator, could do a workshop on it. And I would actually love to hear what the LID standards are, because I've been out of the loop for about at least three years. So I have no idea what the LID standards are.
So these are preliminary, and they put them out for public comments. So public comments due July 22nd is the due date. And so Jamie and Angela and I met yesterday to talk about maybe our staff comments. And this, just the timing of this was really good for you all to weigh in on the parking issue. The parking has to do with impervious cover. And so there's also a meeting next week. There's technical groups. I'm not closely involved with it. Angela and Jamie are, but I offered to get this input from you all. So we'll just go, I think we'll do this first. It's a little bit different, then I think we could be on the matrix for hours. So the performance standards, this is all about minimizing impervious area. And the part that has to do with us for this purpose is highlighted. And so they're proposing, and these, just so you know, these would be requirements that we would have to adhere to. They would be greater than maybe state requirements for the rest of the state if you're not in municipal.
Excuse me, is there any way you can expand that just a bit, zoom in just a bit? Possible, if not, no worries.
Down in the
lower
right hand corner. Yeah.
Thank you.
It's also on page 3 of our handout.
Oh, well, thank you. It'd be easier. Thank you for that.
So the first one, incorporate maximum parking standards 9 foot by 18 foot. We've got that. That's checked. When we did our proposal for parking and layout, we took away that little, the big parking space option. So Costco is the last place that will have the larger parking space. The second one.
Oh, yeah. So this is a reduction in the current code?
We had a 9 foot by 18. This is just some communities have larger 10 by 20 spaces.
Okay.
We removed that already. The second one, use single lane, one way head in angled parking. We are not actually a fan of that. So it's not really conducive to getting people in and out of a site. It's really actually, so we'll probably be making comments to not do that one because it's just doesn't work for development sites, especially because we only want one entryway into a site. So when you have a one way, you have to have two entryways into a site, an entrance and an exit always. It doesn't always work.
Why is that a low impact?
I'm not really sure.
Oh,
we
okay.
Actually, that was a question. Like, what is this? And
yes.
What were you thinking?
Okay. It wasn't obvious to me.
So these optional standards are things that really have to do with parking. And so they have a proposal, offer a waiver for minimum parking standards. I think, jump in whenever. I think this is sort of in line with what we've been thinking with these parking standard changes that we might have an opportunity for a waiver if the development has a proposal that's by a professional.
Does the state have a notion of what is a highly urban area? I mean, we've got the town and village construct, we've got the focused development construct, but does the state have a notion of that?
It's a great question because we have several questions about define what this means.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Okay.
I would think that this would mean what we think it means, but we have asked for a definition of clarity because they use the word rural and suburban in the beginning, and then urban shows up here. So,
well, and suburban in particular is the most ambiguous term.
Yes.
So,
And I'd say urban is one of the most weirdly used terms in Maine because
there's urban areas
where. No. You come from.
Right.
But
urban
there's really
not
no
existing in Maine.
That's defined. Urban and rural,
and so
but not suburban.
We just have to make sure that we are in line. And what we've also talked about is maybe if it's this loose definition that allows the community to define it for ourselves. So we would have to define that. So I would consider this, we may have a waiver in our Running Hill District or TDC District or CBD District for this type of thing where we allow greater density. So I think this one is okay. I think this is in line with what we've been talking about. Establish in lieu of parking programs with the following components. So a fee in lieu of parking, a car share in lieu of parking, a transit in lieu. I don't know if we're ready for those three. I don't think they're bad ideas. I just don't know. We don't have anything created for that. But bike pedestrian infrastructure improvement, I think we are a little bit more ready for that. So that, again, the way they have these written, they're optional. I don't know how it's going to shake out. You know, one of them may be required, one are maybe optional. But what are your thoughts about those four?
The fee in lieu of parking, is that just a fee paid by a developer to not have to be?
Right. So it'd be for a community that has a parking garage or centralized parking or on-street parking or some other way. And then the developers building, maxing out their buildable lot and not parking it.
Well, we talked last month about the idea that there were adjacent properties that they have either time availability or just extra availability of spaces. Fee in lieu of maybe a way of of offering adjacent properties to not have parking, but take advantage of the fact that there are parking, there is parking nearby.
Are you talking about shared parking agreements?
Well, yeah, because we talked about some of the challenges of shared parking agreements last month. A fee in lieu of maybe a way to give developers an economic framework to develop those sharing arrangements on their own.
But it's a one-time fee, and parking management, it goes in perpetuity. So I'd want to see some type of parking management plan or template worked out, so that the developer then had to go to the abutters and any other property owners who are willing to share in the parking agreement and get it to run with the land.
So it sounds like we're not opposed to this being an option, but it's not a fully baked option. We would have to really, as a town, if this gets adopted by the state and we have to enforce it and say it's not optional, we really have to think about how we want to enforce
this. One thing that we do not have that I'm aware of is a parking lot, unless you get down to the beach area, right? We have no parking lots.
But when I don't count, but it's how many spaces are next to a lot of, I don't remember. That's technically it.
Oh, yeah, that one always the amount of
parking.
Yes. Yeah.
I think there's 20 maybe that
yeah.
are ours. 25?
Yeah.
So that's. That's a
yeah.
legit parking lot. I thought that was part of the amount.
No, that's what I.
Okay.
Lot line runs right through the middle.
Okay.
Yeah.
The only thing that, the reason why I brought it up was because maybe the fee in lieu of, would we want to consider, and we don't have a lot of location, and whether or not we're missing one of the downs, I don't know, but. Actually build a parking lot and have fees that are collected to either build and or maintain a parking lot where it would make sense to have one. Something along that line.
Like almost like a ride share, like right next to the Cabela's is the ride share for the highway.
Right.
Something similar to that.
Something, either something like that or just physically a paid or an unpaid parking lot.
Well, I think as we look at Oak Hill,
yeah.
we're going to see the parking lots for the high school and all that. Those are pretty substantial impervious cover areas that are parking lots for the high school.
Right.
But they are within a quarter mile, I look further down, they're a quarter mile adjacent certainly to a lot of commercial activity. So there's options for the town to consider for that.
Robin. Yeah, Robin is a good
Yeah, thanks, I'm jumping out of my skin. two things. This is why we need a parking inventory, which was requested at the last meeting, so that we can do a build out, so we can understand where all the public parking is available in the town. And then we also have to understand like who's gonna do the in lieu fee. That's a one-time fee. It's not an annual requirement. So that's my first point. We need a parking inventory so that we know where it is that we're talking about. I have a second point. My second point is that parking garages do not allow incentivization of public transit. So if you're going to be all in on parking garages, why would you want to bring light rail or more speedy buses to the area that, you know, people who can't afford cars can actually use? So parking garages do not allow innovation for us to move away from cars.
I have a question, Robin, on the parking inventory. You said a public parking inventory. I had understood the inventory that we wanted to have with more public and private. So
sure, I like that.
But
yeah.
But I just want to be clear, what were you looking for an inventory on that?
The whole thing, so that we can see what public parking is available and who's
yeah,
saying, in lieu of fee, I want to use the Amato's parking lot, or in, you know, this is where my in lieu fee is going, or this is where I'm going to contribute annually to the operation and maintenance of this parking garage, so that when we have to go to increase stormwater standards, we have a revenue stream.
I just want to say, the inventory I'm thinking of, would include both the parking lot and Amato's behind that, as well as the parking that's around the Amato's. Is that correct?
Well, and I don't know when it's gonna get done, but what we're talking about doing is just an inventory of all of the basically
yeah,
impervious area in town by space, and to see if we had opportunity to restripe and all of that.
That's what I was saying. So it's both existing, what I think it was private,
yeah.
The stuff around Amato's.
Yeah, we don't have we have a little bit of an idea, but not a great idea about
yeah,
what
okay.
we have.
Because that's what I'm hoping to see from the inventory that we've requested. But because if we just get the public, we're going to have just a
handful
of items.
For these, I think these are really great ideas that we would probably as a town be able to get behind as long as they remain optional. That's what I'm kind of hearing, because we're just not ready. We don't have the backup for putting something like this in place yet.
Robert, you had something? Yes, thank you. This is mostly, I'm sorry, I wasn't here last month or several months. This is mostly for development of multifamily and not single family homes, right? Like, is this considered all encompassing, or is this for mostly business?
Well, this particular standard would be for multifamily or business. Or
okay,
whatever.
But not residential, single family.
Right. All of these standards are for everything.
Okay.
This whole
right.
collection.
And you made the comment a second ago about town. You know, I grew up in South Portland, which is technically a city, but certainly if anybody's been to South Portland, there's a lot of suburban areas. And I consider Scarborough completely suburban. Obviously, this is the Long Range Planning Committee, and it may not always be a town. I don't know what it takes to become city status. I believe it's a population.
It's town government. It's basically what
the government that considers it. Because like Biddeford's a city. Even though it may have less.
It's a mayor council.
Yeah.
Okay. That's the requirement,
yeah.
And not
yeah.
not population.
No.
Right. All right. Well, certainly Scarborough's large in geography, so we could conceivably grow a lot more. Perhaps in the future we do change our town city status. Great comment about the fee in lieu of parking. I definitely think if someone is going to develop something, get some land. There should be annual or recurring fee for that, not just a one time. If they're gonna utilize impervious covering over land, they should be required to maintain it, right? And if the town ends up with a piece of property that other people use, there should be a fee, a recurring fee, not just a one timer. I think I'm in agreement.
The only other comment I would make on behalf of Angela and especially Portia, when it comes to the bike pedestrian thing, we want to get input from Transportation Committee, because I know that they're working on bike racks and things of that nature to be placed in public spaces.
I'm working on a town-wide transportation
right.
study that has to do with bike and pedestrians.
Correct. So I just want to make sure that that input gets brought forward as well.
You know, that's a good point, because when I think of infrastructure improvements, I'm not thinking about physical things. I'm talking about bike lanes and dedicated sidewalks or shared use paths, that sort of thing. But yeah, I'll talk.
Mr. Chair, I have one last comment on transit in lieu.
Yes.
What I'm picturing for transit in lieu would be a developer who, instead of offering parking spaces, is perhaps making some kind of contribution to a transit authority to bring or to expand or to amplify transit options for a community. And again, I would say that that's not a one-time fee. That would be an easy.
Yeah, because we pay, we assume an annual recurring fee to
yeah.
participate a bit in that.
RTP, does the city do RTP or anything like that?
I don't think so.
Metro, there's so many bus.
Yeah, and there's talks of those, the existing transit sort of consolidating or figuring out how to make that work better. So that's a good, we'll make sure that it's recurring. If there is any sort of fee, it needs to be recurring on an annual basis.
Actually, Robin, could I ask a question again? your concern on the fee in lieu was a one-time fee. Does it have to be, or can we make that effectively an annual tax?
That's what I'm asking. It's not a tax. That's not a tax, it's a user fee.
That's what we're gonna, our recommendation is gonna be that if there is a fee in lieu, regardless of how it is, a recurring annual fee. So we don't lose that. So that's great.
And it's not, I'd really like us not to talk about it being a tax because it's a user fee. In order to meet regulatory requirements for perpetuity for your project, you have to pay an annual fee.
Yeah.
Which is a user fee, not a tax.
Well, did George Herbert Walker Bush, I think, use the, if it looks like a duck, it smells like a duck, it's a tax.
It's a user fee.
So, exactly, it's a user fee, but I think it actually was his actual phrase. But the concept is the same. It's a recurring, you build it, you pay it every
year.
They
wouldn't have to pay it if they built it to standard.
Right. It would be, so say
actually, that confuses me for what do you, if they
so
built it to
this
standard.
This would be a fee in lieu program. So say I have 100 parking spaces required.
Yep.
And I am in an area designated as urban with high density opportunities. And so I only want to build 25 of those spaces. So for those other 75, I'm going to pay a fee in lieu every year to take it. So my customers in my building have a place to park, and that's how it would work.
Okay, so and again, this might get to where we go to the grid here, because we've talked last month about the idea that what historically we said would require 100 spaces, maybe we shouldn't have 100. We should have
right.
a maximum of 60, so
right, right.
for a number.
Yeah.
But it should. That 100 should no longer be 100. We should bring that down. You're talking about even if we bring it down.
Yep. So say it is 100 after we've decided what it should be, there may be further opportunity for a fee in lieu program to reduce impervious cover.
Okay. So
because of our MS4 standards.
So these MS4 standards are not going to stand in the way of us saying what used to be 100 should
no,
really be
100. No, not
60.
At all. They're
okay.
in fact in support of that. So we're trying to figure the timing.
Okay.
I think is nice that we can figure out how to use this to our
okay.
advantage for some of the things we're proposing.
That's helpful. I was
yeah.
a little confused on that. Thank you very much.
And it wouldn't be, these wouldn't necessarily be designated spaces. In other words,
right.
Yeah. So the same, you could have five developers paying into
it.
The fee. They could be paying for 1,000 spaces together, but there
right.
would only be 500.
Right.
It doesn't have to be a one-to-one correlation.
Yeah,
exactly.
And it's not it's not reserved for their
it's
users.
One-to-one.
It's just
the town should be aware of sort of what the it's, I call it like a build-out analysis.
Mm-hmm.
You sort of have to be keeping track of who's claiming what. For
exactly.
And it's the need for a full private plus public inventory
yeah.
as a baseline.
Yeah, again, I go back to these are all great ideas, but as long as they're optional.
Right.
They become required. We're not ready for that. We would have to get a lot more studies. Let's see. So they have a note that the in-lieu program may optionally be tied to incentives such as density or high bonuses. I think that's great. I think we're on board with that. Establish shared parking provisions. We've been talking about that. I think that's great. It's in line with our discussion. This next one, parking lot travel aisle shall be a maximum of 22 feet wide. We just...
I apologize. Can I take us back one to establish shared parking provisions? This is what I'm getting at. I think we need a template for like a parking management plan.
Right.
Okay. So that it doesn't leave it in the hands of the developer. The developer comes in and says, yep, here's my parking management plan. Well, what criteria do they need to establish? So what I'm saying is if we're not going to establish what the criteria is for shared parking provisions, then we at least need to come up with some type of template that developers can use.
Yeah, I like that idea. We did that, it's different, but we did that with landscaping and I envision it making my life a lot easier.
Yeah.
It's like, here's what we want. Don't tell us what you want to tell us. Tell us what we want to know. I like that. So then we have, so this 22 foot wide parking lot travel aisle, I have a little bit of discomfort with. We have 25 foot is required now. We do waivers every planning board meeting, so we just to 24 foot, which is pretty standard. So we are actually going to have that in adoption, hopefully by the end of September. We'll have our parking aisle with 24 feet. So I don't know if you all, my car's fine in a 22 foot, but I know that there are quite a few vehicles that are not, and my car is not if you're parked right behind me in a 22 foot. So I do have some angst about this one a bit. What do you guys think about this one?
I also want to add to say I've been hit twice in the Hannaford's parking lot by extraordinarily large SUVs backing up whacking the back of my relatively new car. So 22, I'm torn on this one because 22 feet wide, first off, disincents people from traveling in gigantic mega cars into urban parking lots, which is not a bad thing. On the other hand, we're going to have more fender benders.
Sure, they'll still drive.
That's my point. We'll still have the result is more fender benders.
Maybe so. We have larger parking spots reserved in one place.
Large vehicle spots.
Yeah,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Reverse
of
motorcycles.
Right.
Yeah. The reverse of compact.
Yeah, the
compact
reverse of compact.
Up front.
Exactly.
Motorcycles up front. Bicycles up front.
Big truck.
Sorry,
got
to get your F-350 in the back.
Yeah.
So I have a large pickup truck that I use for work, but occasionally I go to Hannaford's or take my kids somewhere because that's just how it works sometimes. It's a 2010, so it's an older truck. I use it to run to Portland and get lobster bait, but it's 8-foot bed with an extended cab. And the trend, obviously, for pickup trucks, everybody knows, is always have an extended cab. Generally, like my nice truck that I drove here with has got a 5.5-foot bed, so it's easier to park.
Mm-hmm.
My father-in-law has the same truck, and he avoids places that have tight parking because he just doesn't want to go there. So I'm not in favor of making them smaller unless there's, you know,
somewhere
that, but even then, even if you have dedicated spots for larger vehicles, if you still have the width area,
right,
you're trying to get in and
out.
Yeah,
I have those concerns too. I mean, we just have an F-150, and I drove it here from Texas, and I remember giggling to myself, when I get my car, it's going to be small. I couldn't park at the beach. I couldn't get anywhere. I don't want anything.
Is it 8-foot bed or?
No, it's just a standard. It's just bigger. The cars in Texas, everybody drives a big truck or a Suburban or something. So here, everybody's Forester, RAV4, you know, Nissan. So it's so much more comfortable to have a smaller car. But I'm sort of torn too. Hey, Rachel.
Yeah, I this simply brings to mind the constant dilemma that I have when somebody comes before the planning board and wants to have the 24-foot aisle instead of the 25-foot aisle. And I'm sitting there and thinking, well, what are you going to do with that foot? In other words, is that going to become impermeable someplace else? Or are you going to add to the number of parking spaces? Or are we going to have more plants, more permeable area? So if we go to 22 feet, where does that saved land go?
Could that be a sketch plan requirement that when they come in with sketch plan, they have to bring some sort of parking templates to show?
Or show what it would look like at 25 feet versus 24 feet. And again, where does that, where does that foot go?
Yeah.
How does it benefit us in terms of landscaping, open space, stormwater, a place to absorb some of the stormwater? Because otherwise, 22 feet, great, I can put an extra row.
That's a great point.
It really
we talked
is.
About that a few months ago with another thing we wanted to do. We wanted to give this idea of height, but we were giving and not take it away, right? So we need to, if we did do this, my comment with Angela and Jamie yesterday, we were talking, like, why don't they just set a maximum impervious cover that we have to allow? Because right now, our impervious cover for the majority of our districts is 75% to 85%. So that's pretty high. And I think it would be easier. These could be optional things, but I think it would be easier if they just said maximum impervious cover is 60%. Have a nice day. Figure it out. And then you do want 22, and then you would be encouraged to do those things if they work for yourself.
I like how you think.
I'm really simple. I'm like, I don't know. Just give me one button. Just one thing.
That was easy.
On that one, on the language, it's not up on the screen right now, but if you go for to the performance standards, it does look like they are moving towards a 70% standard for impervious cover. Am I reading that wrong?
Yeah, it's just that's about runoff. That's not about overall.
Okay. So is that something that we can add to our public comment that there is a gap there of not suggesting a more higher level impervious cover maximum standard?
Yeah, I think that'd be great.
Yeah.
Because I think that would, it really gets it. All of these are really about that, but they're not just saying it.
Exactly. That's kind of what I'm hearing from
this. But be careful how, because when you say you want 60%.
We'll just say a percentage. Okay. Maybe they should.
Perfect. Yeah, I don't know the number exactly.
Not a number, but exactly. Just because every community is
inversely related. Yeah.
Quite different. And, you know, I mean, I said 60%, but I don't really mean that for all areas. Some areas, I really think you should probably be able to maximize the lot because that's where we want our density. And then these areas, it's more like 40%.
Right.
So, you know, it's a tricky slope. But I think having them define it, what about maybe proposing?
Or shoreline zone 0%.
Right. Or I like that. But they could do a rural, urban, and suburban percentage along the lines with their thinking.
Yeah, and this gets to the ambiguity between urban and suburban, really. Because if urban, as I think of it, we should max towards 100%.
Yeah.
But that's not a main standard to grab on your point.
Yeah.
You know, that might be main in the peninsula in Portland, but that's about it.
Maine's urban is not Massachusetts.
Correct. Yes. Exactly. So, but Maine's suburban, therefore, isn't that far away from Massachusetts suburban. So what do we define Maine urban?
It's actually rural.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
So
that's good. I think that's a good comment, though, that they should consider setting the maximum impervious sort of a range for these three distinct areas after they define the three distinct areas.
Yeah, and can we define it based for the town based on other sort of
definitions? I feel like
definitions.
We'll be able to, using our comp plan and our density ranges. I feel like that'll probably be how it works.
But we're going to have to look at our current zoning and assign one of those groups to each zone.
Well, that's great. That's sort of already done with our radio ordinance.
Yes.
So we have area one is R2, RF, RFM, R2, R3, R4, all those sort of just regular density and lower density. And then area two is your TVC, your village residential, your T&D district, all those. So we have it.
But if we look at the development zones, you see a lot of R2 in those as well. So it will, I think, end up begging the question, which is a good thing. What's really R2 versus what is town and village R2 versus non-
Especially in this area, we need to really probably make our zoning more in line with what this is. Okay, so let's see. This next one. Incorporate maximum commercial parking space size with 9-foot by 18-foot length and allow developers to reduce the 18-foot length if an equivalent overhang was provided in all developments.
What does that mean?
I don't really know what that means.
Yeah.
So
like overhang where you pull up to a curb and there's extra space?
I don't know. Because I don't really want you to pull up over the sidewalk either, right? Rather.
Do you think it means like, you know, when we have at the end of like go to Pine Point Beach and at the end of the parking space, there's a curb, you know, in the parking lot. The curb stop. Thank you. I couldn't think of the word. So that your tires can't go past the curb stop into the dune or something like that.
But the front of your vehicle
overhangs.
Yep.
And if that's what they're talking about, I'm still not liking it because then if it's the hood of your car, you could still be leaking vehicle fluids over the overhang.
Okay.
So I'd want to know more information on this.
So
I would too, and when the state talks commercial, I think commercial vehicles. So trucks, loading and unloading zones.
Anything that has to be USDOT placarded.
Yeah, exactly. Which doesn't make this make any sense to me.
Yeah.
Well, I think this is using commercial as in non-residential. like so just a parking lot. But yeah, to your point, we'll just say that this one's not clear.
Yeah.
And
I mean, I have
what we understand of it, we're not a fan.
I have a commercial plate on my little Ford Maverick that doesn't make it a commercial vehicle.
This is commercial parking, not necessarily commercial parking.
So we need a definition there.
Yeah.
Okay. And then this last one, ensure parking volume requirements are up to date. Oh, we're so ahead of this. Including establishing maximum parking limits. We are doing that. Our reduction or elimination of parking may be conditional on presence of transit routes within a quarter mile, existing on street. And I think we're talking about all of that. So I think we're in good shape for that one. You all agree?
Yeah, that's an inventory, right?
Not to add confusion and delay to get through our lengthy agenda. Is there talk of any requirement for plug-in?
We have the EV charger ordinance.
Okay.
It was approved January 2023.
Is it required on commercial development?
Yeah. There's a percentage.
What percentage?
Oh, Rob, it varies.
It does, okay.
Right.
Pretty low.
So, like, no, it's pretty high. Hotels is 100%. It's some, we have three different categories. So you have to have installed, capable, and then ready. So ready is conduit, capables, electric capacity, and then installed, obviously. There is a fee.
You say hotels is 100%?
100%.
Every spot?
Yep.
That's
so
police
conduits.
Oh, wow.
Right.
That's impressive.
And then multifamily has a threshold. We require it for single family. We require for everything. So
okay.
It's in our zoning ordinance article 12.
Hats off to the committee for whoever did that.
The sustainability committee was behind that. And there's a fee in lieu, but it's the right kind of fee in lieu because it's expensive. So if you ever do a fee in lieu and you actually want the reality to occur, you have to make your fee in line, you know, to get it back. So they're pretty good.
So just so we're clear, the fee in lieu would cover the full-on install. You have to get it to a certain threshold. You have to pay enough.
The fee in lieu is based on what you're required. So it's a different fee in lieu. I think it's 8,000 per installed spot, and then it goes down based on,
Is it a one-time fee or is it annual?
It's a one-time fee. And then it goes into a bucket.
I'll buy that.
Okay. Want to move on to our big matrix?
Yep.
All right.
Is this right out of the LID standard in the MS4, or where did this come from before we move on to the parking standard there in yellow that we just reviewed?
It came from the draft.
MS4.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
LID standards from MS4. Their working group is going through. I think Angela's on the technical committee, and then there's another committee.
LID stands for.
We suspect these will be in place next fall.
Who came up with these?
State DP.
Okay, and did the technical committee weigh in on them yet?
Yeah. No. Well,
Angela's on.
They've been
weighing
in, but this is a draft that we're weighing in again on.
Okay.
So it's not finalized.
Yeah, the committees met like last summer to give feedback.
And they keep going back and forth.
Yeah, exactly. What we have. Exactly. And part of a lot of the discussion was about what's going to be optional versus what's required.
Winter comments, Jim?
July 22nd.
Can I maybe meet with you?
Sure. All right. All right, we'll go to. So I have a big disclaimer, no one panic about any use that you're like, oh my God, I didn't know that was allowed in this district. This is a very quick, high level, I did not pick up all the weird little special exceptions, size constraints, all that. This is just for us to have a generalized conversation about parking. I'm just going to put that out here. I wish our zoning ordinance was this simple and then we would have this easily, but it's not. So I tried to organize this by village, and then I reached the village, and and identify what zoning district is in it. And the purpose of this is, so we've been talking about doing Oak Hill as our first village master plan, if you will, and that would touch base with uses, not so much, but more about architecture and how it specifically works. Also parking, pedestrian amenities, that sort of thing. So we can really create these places that are, while they're special now, they're more special and they take advantage of what's already existing in each village. So Oak Hill at Eight Corners would look distinctly different, but you would know you were in Oak Hill and still in Scarborough. So that's the goal with that. So I went ahead and did that. And so
quickly,
yeah.
are we going to have an opportunity? I mean, like, did we lose our opportunity to maximize density in Oak Hill when we did that, the height of the building?
I think we lost that specific opportunity.
That's really disappointing.
Well, not the development, though. We didn't lose the development, but we lost that. But I think as part of this master plan, it's possible to get it back.
Okay.
Right, because I think.
From a regulatory standpoint,
ship
has sailed right now.
Yeah.
Any development moving forward right now goes to, what did we talk about, 60, or did it get?
No, they still have to do the 45 feet.
They have to do 45, that's too bad, okay.
And they were, remember, he was only asking for a couple of feet, and he's actually made it work. So I suspect that specific development will still be coming through. But when we do, I envision when we do this Oak Hill master plan, we have a consultant, and we have community and people in that area of the Shred, that will really give us the backing for proposing a higher height, if, you know, if that takes place based on that participation.
And remind us, when we proposed 60, 65, we had the fire equipment. We have the fire equipment to deal with that, right? So really, there's no reason not to. I mean, other than what was discussed in that meeting.
I think it's more just about aesthetics and the unknown and how we would need to address our impervious cover. The downs is building higher, more and more higher things. And I think people are probably going to be like, they are able to visualize that more as that goes on. So I suspect that it's possible.
What's the height requirement for the downs?
75 feet.
Okay, good. All right.
So we have 75 feet in the downs and in Highest Parkway. We have a 6-story hotel that's come through as a sketch plan on the corner of Highest Parkway and Payne Road. That's big.
That's high. That's
tall.
High traffic zone already.
Yeah. So that's how I've laid this out. So I think we can build on it, and we could do it any different way. But I wanted to just tell you kind of what it is. So basically, the top part of the different villages with the zoning that is in it. So if we were going to look at just Oak Hill, we'd hide all the other columns and we'd just look at those zoning districts. So we talked about doing parking based on village area. So then we get into the parking requirements. So these are the existing standards. And then of course, where they're allowed throughout the zoning district. So single family requirement, you know, 2 for each dwelling unit. And what I'm envisioning as we work through this, tell me if you had different ideas, is that we would replace, we could say, okay, this X is fine, we'll go with the standard, but maybe in in BR2, we say that it's 1.5. per unit. So that's how I envision us working through it in this. We'll funnel it down through the village, and then we can look at the specific uses that are allowed if you want to go that route. I think that makes sense. We can have this, we did this with landscaping, and I think it works well. We have sort of this base idea of, these are our base standards, but then in specific special areas, it goes like this. What do you think about that?
Like optional?
No, it wouldn't be optional. It would be different set of requirements.
Okay.
So, and in this case, it would be a reduced set of requirements based on the uses. Robin's giggling. I don't know what that means.
Single family units, 2 parking spaces for each. Like, if we're going to go 7 stories high.
Well, those wouldn't be single family units. Those would be in your multifamily. So multifamily can be for rent or owner.
Still, if you're so, if you're rich enough to have a quarter acre, you can have two spots for your cars.
Single family usually is what, 2 point something people?
Well, now let's talk about Scarborough. What's a single family like in Scarborough?
I have three vehicles in my house. And my daughter hasn't got hers yet, so that'd be four.
But it's the idea that it's required, I think, which I think Robin, you're talking about. I don't get that either.
What?
As a requirement. I can get it as probably what you're targeting as a developer or whatever, but
how are we going to get transit here if everybody can drive a car?
Well, that's the thing. We're not going to get transit in your west of the turnpike for now. We have to think. I want you to focus on specific. Would it be easier to focus on just Oak Hill?
Single family, though, single family includes town, village, country, town, village, TDC too.
Mm-hmm.
Should it? I'm not sure it should. And this is where, if I get to the zoning map too, R4 is a lot of what's around Oak Hill. Does R4 single family need to be two car minimum?
Exactly. That's why I think we have this discussion.
And I guess that's where I get.
What if you have an attached parking garage?
Yeah.
Your garage is attached? It's ridiculous.
So this doesn't.
It's a lot of impervious cover.
It is. And I look down here, multifamily R4 is checked with two cars per dwelling or two parking spaces per dwelling.
They have two or more bedrooms, right? Can we look at one zoning district and then maybe you just kind of talk about it? And let's look at, which one do you guys want to look at?
Okay. And this is where I know that there's no R2 check for the Oak Hill area here. I think that's not accurate.
If I look at what I think of as being Oak Hill, I just called up the GIS map.
Mm-hmm.
There's overlap in the R2 districts.
Okay, we can leave it.
So and that partially gets you, we've got the town and village concept within the zoning ordinance. You've defined villages here, I think mapping roughly to what we use villages within the...
I use the comp plan.
The comp plan, yeah, exactly.
So I added some...
I mean, just let's think about 50 years out from now. Do we really want, like, if I build a duplex, two-family home, and it, there's an attached garage on each side? That could go right to the street, like.
Well, we don't have a garage requirement.
No, but if you had a garage,
yeah,
couldn't you consider that a space?
Yeah, it counts. So it would be part of your two. Okay. So not happening today.
Sorry, we've derailed you.
It's fine. I was just trying to hide the stuff so we could just really talk about. So I just want to talk about all right, so Oak Hill, these are generally the districts that are in Oak Hill. And so what I would envision is we could look at what we have, and I don't know if we're ready to do this. Maybe we have to wait until we get the actual inventory and we go through the master planning process. But this is what exists today. And there may be some changes that we are like, that's crazy, we need to fix this. But it sounds like doing it based on the villages starting to make sense to you all and how we might prefer it rather than this townwide standard. Retail gets the same amount of parking townwide.
You know, I was one when we got on the planning board going, why do we have these village standards at Kids Beach? Why do we have these, you know, why can't we just have standards throughout the town? So I guess what I'm asking is, are you trying to like get us to like what the overarching requirements are?
Oh.
And then we go.
So right now I'm trying to get you folks on Oak Hill, but I'm thinking we'll have base standards.
Mm-hmm.
And then Remember when we did architecture, we had reserved for future village standards? So this would be the same way. We have these base standards where this is our general, but if you're in this area and we would designate it with a map and a boundary, so we would have that, you follow these reduced parking standards. That would be how this would work. Sort of like in the village standards for architecture, we have these base standards. You can have, you know, if you're gonna have a pitched roof, it's minimum 512. You can use this list of materials, flat roofs are okay, blah, blah, blah. But in maybe in Oak Hill, you have to use clapboard and you have to use shingles and it's a 812 roof pitch. I'm just kind of being extreme. So that's how this would be too. So you'd have basic parking and then specific for these villages. Because our villages in town are unique. That's what makes us, we don't have a downtown, we don't have really a place, but we have all of these places. And trying to really hone in on that, I think, is what the comp plan says to do, and then what I've heard you all say we really want to.
Well, I think the comp plan process brought out from the town that they wanted to maintain that distinctiveness among villages.
Exactly.
They didn't want a single Scarborough thing to emerge.
I think we do one, it'll get easier.
We're just gonna get through the first one. So let's see if we can.
Will it include Eastern Village? If we do Oak Hill, are we like, so we're talking Eastern Village, we're talking, okay, yeah. All right.
I didn't bring in the TND just because it has its own weird thing. I think it might be too complicated for us to talk about right now. It's the traditional neighborhood zone. It's just Eastern Village is the only one.
Gotcha.
I don't want to talk about Eastern Village.
I would agree with that.
Like,
a lot of reasons. But for example, and this is where I get the R2 is
part
of
the right? I'm sorry.
It's okay. This is where I think the R2, there are bits of R2 that are part of the zone.
Mm-hmm.
It's the stuff on the left hand side of Sawyer Road, which is R2 between that and them. But that to me is still part of the Benson Hill, or sorry, Oak Hill area. And then there's smidges of R2, and it depends on how far we want to go, but there's the R2 that, what's the name of that road that everybody wants to put speed bumps on?
Maple Ave.
That's the Maple Ave starts to get to the edge of it, but we should probably think about, do we include that as part of that? Because it's fairly dense. It's the older area that is fairly dense, and probably is the most easily pedestrian and bike connectable area to Oak Hill, to expand the density concept within Oak Hill.
Yeah, I think that area should definitely include it. And I will say, I think, I don't want to get this off track, but I think part of that master planning process may include some appropriate zoning of land.
Yeah.
And so, because in that area, for instance, I've had an issue where someone had a vacant parcel and they wanted to build a house on it, which seems like a completely reasonable request because it was the same size lot as their neighbors. But because it had been included in another home lot for a period of years, they did not meet the lot requirements in the R2 zoning.
Yeah.
And that to me is just silly. Like, that was the perfect infill opportunity. It matched, but our zoning ordinance didn't allow for it. So, it seems really silly. So I'm hoping that area may
be doable through like a waiver or?
No.
and thinking from the zoning board perspective, you look at lots in the R2 zone, that historical lots that are now R2 that look like R4 lots.
Mm-hmm.
And the neighborhood is an R4 district if you made any other determination. So,
So R2 may go away for Oak Hill.
Got it. Okay.
And
that would be
those may get rezoned. So, yeah, I just want to put that up. I think those areas are definitely included in my mind.
We'll make ZBA much happier.
Yeah.
So,
if we're just talking about that area where we do have single family allowed, it is, you know, the two per dwelling unit. For two family, it's two per dwelling unit. Multifamily, it's based on the number of bedrooms.
Before you get away from that, though, is this notion that parking is required?
Yes, it is required. This is required.
Yeah. So,
And right now we don't have a maximum. So you could do a single family home with 7 parking spaces.
There's one in my neighborhood, yeah.
Does it have to be impervious cover, or could it be semi-impervious? Could it be gravel?
Well, we consider gravel impervious.
We do.
We do, because it gets filled up and packed down.
Yeah.
It's the same. It functions the same over time. And you have to build the driveways to the same standards.
Okay.
So,
doesn't matter what the cover is.
Yeah, this is where I would think we could have differential requirements for R2 versus R4, for example.
Okay, so let's talk about, so maybe R4 is where it's, does it drop down to 1 point? I don't know if we're gonna see any real significant changes. And it's also important for you guys to know too, we don't have a lot of vacant land left in R4, so we don't probably need to kill ourselves in the weeds.
No, but this is where I think changing the Maple Street area from R2 to R4 would A, make sense, and B, then this would have an impact because suddenly there's a lot of air of development that could be opened up for densification of an area close to or pedestrian bike friendly to the Oak Hill complex.
So are we thinking 1.5 as a minimum? And sometimes just putting out there that we're thinking that the minimum is different kind of gets you in a different mindset, even if it might be the first step, you know, it's putting the idea out there.
I mean, I actually think back to my area of Blue Point, which was largely developed in my particular area was largely developed in the 40s and 50s. Most of the units were developed with single car garages and almost no driveway space, and that was perfectly fine. We have evolved, or our expectations have evolved, that we need more than that. But I bought into a house built in 1940 with no garage and 1.5 barely driveway spaces, and I'm adapting. I'm living with it. So I'm thinking that 1.5 for the, in my area is R2 technically, but if you look at where I live on Jasper Streets, they're all R4 size lots.
Right,
they're 0.3, 0.4 acre lots at most. So I think that 1.5 to me makes sense for the smaller, for the residential districts where smaller lot sizes are expected.
You guys keep mentioning Maple Street. Is it actually Maple Ave?
Maple Ave.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
I'm
looking at my map where they're.
I have a brain with bad memories for names, so I apologize for that.
Of course.
So two family, I'm assuming, would be the same sort of thinking then. This is per unit.
Yeah, per unit, yeah.
I'm just going to tie up you guys. No need to stop.
And then again, I'm with Robin that I don't think we need to require it for even R2 or R3, but I think R2 and R3 districts, the lot sizes and the expectations of the separation of things probably make too okay. But I looked at Robin a little bit on this one.
I'm going to highlight these because these are things we probably, this zone might not even should exist.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So multifamily, we have 2 per dwelling unit with 2 or more bedrooms, and then 1.5 for each dwelling unit containing fewer than 2 bedrooms. What are we thinking for that one? Do we like that based on bedrooms, or would we make the 1.5, would we bring it down to 1.5 and then 1? I'm looking to Rachel too. Rachel, you haven't said much. You have a lot of experience with this on planning board.
Yeah. What I can think of recently basically is that developers want to use the street because they, in a sense, they want to maximize the number of parking spaces in the multifamily units. What kind of complaints have you gotten, let's say, from the downs?
The only complaints that I'm aware of is when the ADA parking is not next to the ADA unit, and that is sort of, we didn't think that one through, but that one, I haven't received a whole lot of we get more complaints from the single family folks about parking, that they don't have enough room to have people come over.
At the downs,
yeah.
I think the issue that I see out there is visitors.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if you in those areas at the downs where it's been pretty strict in terms of they've adhered to the number of parking spaces per unit, that works fine until the in-laws come to visit. And I recall what they had to do along the downs. What's the apartment names right along the downs, the first apartment? The ones that look like army barracks?
Upland Carriage. Or the...
In Carriage.
Oh.
Yeah. They had to build an overflow parking lot. Now, both because they had built, were building an additional building, and because folks were just visitors were parking with residents,
right,
would be parking. And I think that created a real crunch. So it's less the number of, it's less a question of the units, parking for the units, than it is when somebody wants to come and deliver something, when a truck wants to stop, when the in-laws come to visit, when somebody wants to hold a party. And all of a sudden available spaces are taken up. When the carriage, whatever apartments were being built, as I recall, there were, I think, 7 spare parking lots that to handle all the visitors for the Gristmill buildings and the apartment units. And I basically was thinking, ain't gonna work. But that's what, you know, it was built according to specs. So I think this works with some caveats as soon as you're dealing with large apartment buildings.
What if, instead of trying to say, you need so many extra parking spaces for that instance, visitors, whatever the case might be, you add a requirement that says in that multifamily type environment, you need, pick a number, 0.25, 0.5 spaces per unit in a designated area for visitor parking. Would that, something like that make sense?
Are you talking about
beyond what would be required?
That's what I wrote down, that we could define the number per unit required, and we could still base it on the bedroom, but we might reduce this, and then a number based on a percentage
or per visitor parking.
Percentage
so
per visitor, right.
100 units, you have to have 10, I don't know.
Yeah.
Something like that is what I was kind of thinking. So we could reduce the basic, but we still acknowledge the visitor thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, and some of the other units over there have got stacked parking. In other words, they've got a garage space,
yep,
and the other unit is in front of the garage. So each apartment is required to manage its own parking and to decide which car is available to move.
I will say that we have an example just down the street, the Willowdale Commons. They're just 4-unit townhome, and they each have garage space and the space in front, and they have a real problem because it is, I think it's because it's so small. You know, it's probably easier when you have a larger community, but when you have just this really small little infill, you probably should keep the minimum parking the way it is, I'm thinking, because like that is a real world example that just doesn't work for them.
It does not work because
they don't have enough places. Because they've filled up their garage with things, like everyone does. And then that is not a parking space.
Right.
And so that is always something to consider too. Does a garage, it's great that it can count, but should it count? You know, that's the,
I use mine as a clubhouse.
Yeah.
I really think that we need to start thinking about this in terms of water quality. You can require all the parking you want, but that is going, impervious cover is going to be the basis of fees that will need to be assessed to the town when water quality in the marsh plummets. When we've built out the two primary watersheds that feed the marsh in the downs, and we have not put away any money for protection and restoration projects for the marsh. So what's happened in the city of Portland is you get, it's not a tax, it's a user fee. You get a stormwater utility fee for having, you know, a minimum of two parking units on your property, plus all your, you know, families pay an ERU, like an equivalent resident unit, okay? So you just get a flat fee for being a resident. But should you, if you've built seven parking spaces, and I'm not talking existentially here, people, I'm talking Conservation Law Foundation is making all of the Charles River look at residual designation authority, which means Charles River is not meeting water quality standards. And so now you're going back and applying retroactive regulations on existing development. Does this sound familiar to anyone? Where does this happen in our city, in our towns? Long Creek Watershed Management District. And when they finally figure out that Long Creek is not effective in bringing back water quality standards to Long Creek, they're going to realize that we've got to do something else in Maine. And if the marsh is our brand, are we going to keep building impervious cover? When does this stop? When do we start saying, why wouldn't we only just need 20% max or 25% max on a residential unit? I think it's, we can talk out of both sides of our mouth here too and say, well, we need parking because, you know, there's no place to drop off packages, when we're not doing anything to incentivize or innovate transit here in the town of Scarborough. Unless, tell me what it is. I really don't know what it is to incentivize transit for people who.
I think we have, to be fair, we have some really good zoning in existence right now with some density and density bonuses and things like that. But we don't have maybe like the height, or we don't have the reduced parking defined. We have like the idea. So we're on board with the idea and the comp plan. And I think this is the really hard part. Like the really weedy, like the concept is there. We want density in certain areas. We think transit's a great idea. Sort of we're set up for that. But now we have to figure out how to make it work. And to your point, Robin, residential districts do not have maximum impervious cover requirements in the town of Scarborough. I can pave my entire home lot, and I just can't.
Yep.
So that all those R districts, there's no impervious cover requirement.
It all adds up.
Maybe that's an easy fix. And then you say, okay, you need two parking spaces. That's sort of a given.
Where's the runoff going? It's all going into curb and gutter systems. Is it not? It's all going into curb and gutter systems. So there's no place to take out the vehicle fluids. You know, it really depends on, I'm sorry, I'm getting literally
into the
weeds.
There's going to be a reduction in vehicle fluids as we approach, you know, required EVs. So there's one glimmer of hope for you, Robin. And I'm seeing these recurring things. We have a rate of growth ordinance committee, right? That's to try to temper our growth.
It's too late. We have low impact.
But well, where are our children going to move to? If they want to live in Scarborough, where are we going to put them? Like my children are going to be of age in 10 years. I would love to have them in Scarborough. So
yeah.
It is a very slippery slope, and it's a very weedy kind of thing. So we got to do our best. It probably isn't going to be perfect. And yeah, I mean, I'm on the Coastal Waters Committee. I'm a commercial fisherman for 40 years. I'm on the Coastal Waters Committee, and you know what comes up every week? Water quality. You know what is in our marsh, which is the most wonderful marsh in Maine, Scarborough Marsh. It's a nursery for everything. I care deeply about the water quality. So we need to reduce our
dependence on oil and internal combustion engines, which then reduce the runoff, the fluids, like you mentioned. But all that takes time, and all that is not going to happen overnight. So we're going to try our best, right? That's all we can do.
When did you move to town?
20 years ago.
Were you here in the 90s?
No.
What was going on in the 90s?
A lot of missed opportunities. And we have a lot of sense of our past that we need to really be thinking about, because, and it's going to, we're going to have water quality. How often are the water quality exceedances happening now?
Well, Jones Creek is usually open for digging, so that's a good thing, unless we have an inch of rain or more. And that's, so I grew up in South Portland, and Willow Beach is kind of like the poster child for poor water quality, right? And they have a flag system, a color system that they heist every day. We're talking about that at the coastal waters. What are we going to do? How are we going to, you know, implement it? There's four different people that are testing the water, but they're not talking together.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't know the water quality on a daily basis unless you are a harbor master.
Mm-hmm.
So
I just feel like water quality is everybody's job, not one person's
absolutely.
Job.
Clean
and
water
so
and clean air are the most important things in the world.
I want us to be sitting here looking at, you know, what are we leaving for your children?
Right.
I've already, you know, we won't talk about privilege and what, you know, people have moving forward here.
Mm-hmm.
But let's talk about what we have on our hands, which are decreasing water quality standards rapidly,
right.
Increasing climate change, lack of resiliency. We've got to put our money where our mouth is and make, like, decide what we want to do for long-range planning. Long-range planning doesn't mean 5 years from now, the next NPDES permit cycle. Doesn't mean 10 years from now. What does it mean to us? I think about 100 years from now. I think about my granddaughter's granddaughters.
Mm-hmm. Good. I hear you. I'm a little taken aback at the tone, because you're implying the rest of us are. And I do resent that.
Can
I
we
just we need a timeout?
Yeah, I think
yeah, but
I'm
agreeing. That's what I'm getting.
You seem to be drifting away from the topic at hand.
Exactly,
drifting on these policy discussions.
Yeah, well, like
good,
say,
but
I think that's why you all are here, right? You bring
right.
different thoughts and representation to the discussion, but as long as we can keep the discussion based on what we're trying to achieve. I think we're trying
going
to
an impervious cover standard
yeah,
is
yeah.
what I was trying to
yeah,
propose.
I think,
yeah.
And I was trying to give the reasons for going to
and
an impervious cover standard.
I think we all
standard.
Agree.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't think
I think
anybody
we
disagrees.
All agree that impervious is really where we're trying
right.
to
But to sit here and like split hairs over 1.5
yeah.
between 1 and 2 parking spots just seems like we're missing the forest for the trees. And that was my point. So I apologize for any tone and any issues that I may have raised, especially with the new member kind of a thing. But this is where I want us to be thinking on the long range planning committee, not what development is in front of the planning board and what the sins of the past have already been. And we're looking at Long Creek in our.
But I see it as passion, not necessarily as tone.
Thank you, Alan.
We're approaching 9:20 here also from a time check standpoint. So if we're going to get through the rest of the agenda, this discussion is probably getting very close to done.
Yeah.
However, I did see Karen's hand up.
I just had a quick question whether or not it would be helpful to see from the census data, we know the number of cars per household per unit and for different types of units.
Yeah.
If that would be helpful to see where we are now and maybe where we are compared to, you know, downtown Portland or an urban area, a more urban area. If that's helpful, I'll pull those numbers for you.
That'd be really helpful for me. I can insert it like right in the column and we can see kind of where we are
right.
And maybe we can kind of come up with our goal and how we get there.
And that way you get to
yeah.
see
our
hey,
reality
you,
and how we,
yeah.
we might be better than we think already.
Yeah,
well,
or if you lower the standard, this already exists in a different neighborhood. So
we're like I believe we're the seventh largest facility. We're six now? We're number six? Okay. So, I mean, there's not a lot above us to compare to, but if we, I don't know how hard it is to pull the data, but
it's
that would be interesting.
It's not hard at all. And I'm thinking compared to different sub-neighborhoods, like within Portland seems to be the place. So again, it just gives you a feeling for, if you did reduce the standards, hey, it's not so, it,
yeah.
it's not bad.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
It looks like this.
Yeah, no, I think that's great. That's really helpful, actually.
I feel like we also need the parking inventory, Mr. Chair, so that we can understand what we're talking about as far as the oceans of impervious cover that are currently exist.
Yeah, I want to back up that one, because I feel like that is a real data gap in my mind. Without having that inventory of current available public and private parking spaces, I feel like I'm splitting water.
Yeah.
Okay.
Splitting hairs.
Well, that, I can't give you that.
Sure. No, but.
So I'm going to move to staff updates and let you know that Eric is leaving us.
Oh.
No.
So Eric's last day is August 9th.
Is it because you can't find a parking spot?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll let Eric tell you why he's leaving us.
My fiance just graduated from physician assistant school from the University of New England, specializing in rural medicine. So we are moving to Aroostook County.
Whoa, congratulations.
Yes, be quite the change, but we're excited.
Incredible.
So, I've been honored to work with you guys and really excited that my last day I'll get to spend with you at the August meeting.
Nice. How far up the county?
Presque Isle-ish.
Wow. Let's just get into the county.
That's a city.
I'm gonna start crying. So just,
I've loved working here. It's been a privilege. I mean, I'm a resident too, so I really love Scarborough, and I'll be sad to leave, but it's an exciting new chapter. Whoever comes in is gonna be really lucky to be able to work with all of you and Autumn and everybody. So
thank you for all that you've done, Eric.
Thank you.
You'll be missed as a resident too.
Thank you. I haven't been here long, but I felt welcome. So
good luck. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's all I have for staff updates. My sadness.
Karen.
I'm good. I guess I would say that we are experimenting with a new data set that gives us a lot of really detailed information. We just got access to it this week. And we can begin to look at smaller areas within the community and look at employment in different areas. So we're working on getting that up and running, and hopefully that'll become a tool that we might take advantage of at some point.
Great. Robert?
What are you asking for?
Just any
committee member updates.
Yes.
Well, I was recently appointed to Coastal Waters and had our meeting a couple days ago, first one. And mostly it was the Harbor Master giving updates. What did come up though was water quality, parking didn't come up, I'm trying to think, just more moorings, which I feel, you know, we recently were dredged in Scarborough River by the Army Corps, or contractor by the Army Corps of Engineers, and it was overdue. We had struggled to get in and out of that harbor at low tide, and now we can leave just about any tide except for a real drainer, full moon tide. But what happens is it fills back in from the sediment upriver. So right now it's navigable and it's great, but we may do maintenance dredging. York County has dredging equipment, so we have to figure out how to implement maintenance dredging, and it will be less costly than hiring the full-blown dredging operation that we had this time.
Robert, how was the, this was a full-blown inventory or a full-blown dredging, when was the last time this was done?
Actually was done 2 years prior.
Oh, okay.
On a smaller scale.
Gotcha.
But and before that was I believe around 5 years. But it's certainly maintenance dredging will be cheaper, and we can pinpoint, because we use the river every day and we know where the high spots are, so we can sort of pinpoint where we need to have the spot stretch so we can get in and out,
which is essentially low scale but constant dredging is what
annually, semi-annually, yeah. Yeah, that would probably
help frame it in my mind.
Sure, no problem. Yeah, you know, I think
where
it's
are
an
the spoils going?
You know, the spoils this time went on the beach, but they got pumped ashore. It's all soft bottom and tested. I assume it was tested, and not hot. Eventually, if we do run into hot bottom, I would say that has to be mitigated somewhere.
Are you getting brownfields funding for this at all? Like Portland Harbor is?
No, I don't believe so. There's been no discussion of the funding yet.
Would you find out about the spoils in the testing for us?
Would I find out about the spoils? Sure.
In the testing?
Yeah.
Robin?
I just want to apologize for getting a little heated. This is, I hope you understand the scale that I was talking about to start the meeting, being asked to talk about the municipal separate storm sewer system and what's happening there, and then to sit here and split hairs over one or two parking spaces when we were sitting here with an ocean of pavement in the town of Scarborough. And I would respectfully ask that the town's GIS person just put together a rough plan of impervious cover.
We have that
to bring to the next meeting.
Okay, yeah.
So that we can take a look at it and understand the scale that we're talking about and the percent change that has happened in the last 5 and 10 years. And I just want to say also that the vulnerability assessment working group meeting, the next one is on July 17th next week. I'll be attending, and there's also an open space public meeting on July 25th if anyone is interested in being part of the open space workshop, and there's going to be booths at all of the Thursday night conferences,
yes.
I believe. So
yeah, Thursday.
Please take a look and see what's happening there.
We appointed someone from our committee to be on open space committee.
Good.
So,
he's a new member, Kyle. Get his last name.
And I'll forward you all the flyer. The Open Space Committee, just to follow up, our website's live now, and it's really great. There's, if you can't come to the Open Space Committee meeting, you can participate still online. So I'll forward that all information to you.
Robin, you mentioned the 717 meeting. What was that?
Yeah, that's for the vulnerability assessment.
Vulnerability.
Yeah, it's a working group meeting. I think it's open to the public, but basically being on a committee, we have a seat at the table kind of a thing. So if you want any committee questions or anything to go to that, please let me know. But I just want to thank staff again. My comments were in no form to be critical of all the hard work that staff is doing.
Yeah, I guess there's something in the air because we have four hotels being built in Scarborough or proposed in Scarborough after not having any for years. So one on Mossy Road, that's I guess they're starting construction. One on Payne Road near Sebago Brewing, that's got a preload up. One came before us as a sketch plan on Payne Road across from Ginn Road next to the Acura. And the fourth one is in the parking lot of Cabela's. So that offers some interesting opportunities for infill. That's proposed. We haven't seen a pile of work on it yet. But after not really seeing hotels for a long time, and we've got a bunch of them. Coming before the planning board on Monday is a look at the proposed FedEx facility on Holmes Road. What that facility exposed is the issue, the increasing problem, I guess, with the Payne Road, Holmes Road intersection. According to the information that should be available up on our planning board web there, that's becoming an F intersection, a failing intersection, with a 50 car backup southbound heading to the light at Costco. So while a couple of years ago we thought we had it done right, or that the TMP was done right in terms of the queuing, it's not. So that undoubtedly will be part of the discussion, I would think. And it's going to have to be ongoing because I've sat in those lines and it's really not good. For whatever reason, our planning wasn't good. Autumn, do you have any follow-up on that?
That one's been an interesting project for traffic impact. I will say next Wednesday, we have two new traffic impact fees that are being proposed for adoption, and they have both have to do with Payne Road. One is about the bridge, and one is for the Ginn Road intersection, and both of those include expanding the Payne Road goes two, four, to, you know, the whole way, so it would be four lanes throughout with the divided, but it's an impact fee. So as development comes through, they have to pay that based on their trips. And it's, they're very high dollar projects. So hope, I mean, it's not anything that's gonna be fixed in the next 5 years, but maybe 10 based on development. But we're still working with FedEx traffic engineers. The more information we get, the more questions they're going back and forth, so.
Yeah, it's the addition of FedEx to the road, if it goes through, is not really significant, but the study uncovered a lot of the issues that people kind of knew were there if you were traveling it. But now we have some real data, and it is concerning.
And then that's where two of the four hotels. Or is it
well, they're on Payne. They're on Payne Road.
Yes.
Two closer to, you know, right at exit 42.
One at
traffic.
Yeah, two of them are right at exit 42. Yeah.
And then one.
Which will just increase the traffic.
Well, or they go down straight down Highgas and onto Route 1, which would then increase traffic along Route 1.
Which is going to be underwater again. So, next big storm in the winter.
That's great for water quality.
Peter.
Nothing to report on the zoning board. It's actually been fairly quiet there. And hopefully that will continue through the summer. We like quiet in the summertime. We had attended my first transportation committee meeting last month as a liaison from us here. We saw the first or second draft of a transportation study. As a study, it was fairly interesting, just kind of to note some of the issues, including on Payne Road, what we just kind of discussed was laid out evident and made quite evident there. But in terms of I think what the committee was hoping for, and in terms of more of a master planning kind of guidance document for the transportation committee, we didn't really get that from this study. It was much more of a study of roads and intersections and what is going on today, rather than a what, given the long range plan, given the comprehensive plan, given developments, sort of trends, et cetera, what are trend areas of focus for future transportation consideration and infrastructure development. So we communicated that. I think Autumn and the planning team have that in hand, and the town engineer has that in hand. And so we'll hopefully see an improved next draft to help guide some thinking.
Thanks. Mr. Cheney.
One very quick thing, somewhat keen off what Robert's been talking about. The council is taking up the $6 million land bond proposal at Wednesday's meeting. There's a workshop at 6, followed by the meeting itself at 7. There'll be public comment, and the council will be voting on that. And care about land conservation and making funds available for it, that's the time to go and speak in favor of it. So 6 o'clock, I think the workshop is 6, or 5:30 actually, the council. So
there's going to be for November ballot.
Yes, this is the vote. Go ahead and put it on the ballot.
Yeah, and if I could just follow up, I'm on the Parkson Conservation Land Board that's proposing that $6 million bond. If you care about the conservation and what can be done with that, it's not just getting the council to put it out as a bond. It's in ensuring that the people in Scarborough understand what it means, and the importance of that bond, what we could do with it, you know, how it can affect Scarborough. We've There's a the new Silver Brook Reserve. How many acres did that reserve?
By Broad Turn?
Yeah.
130, I think.
Something like 130 acres that links another 700 acres. So we're making it as the Parks and Conservation Land Board and working with the Land Trust, you know, we're making an impact. What we have left to spend of the last bond is $13,000, which isn't going to buy much.
Nope.
So we need to, if we want to keep going and get towards the goal of 30 by 30, that bond needs to go through.
What are we at now, roughly? What percentage? We're at 20 something to get to 30 by 30. We discussed this at a meeting the other day.
Yeah, I don't know. We're
it's 20 and change.
We're over 1,300 acres preserved.
That's what you
plus
put into that number.
It does, and it's on the link to the website that I'm going to send you. Has that.
Okay.
But that's part of it. It's that what you put in the bucket.
Yeah, yeah. If it's cemeteries or beaches or
schools.
Yeah. Right. Gotcha.
We're closer than we thought we were.
Okay.
One thing for you, Tony Levesque,
okay,
holds multiple positions at Fort Fairfield.
Okay.
If anybody knows what's going on in the county from a planning perspective, Tony Levesque would be a great contact. The other thing is, we've kind of passed through this on a couple of different times, both here at this meeting and also at SEDCO, and that was the concept of food trucks. So just kind of keep that in your minds in terms of what and how we might want to tackle that, because I'm sure it's going to come back to us. So just don't forget that, because you'll see it again. Don't shut your computer down on that spreadsheet that you had after this meeting. I want to make a comment.
Oh, yeah, great.
Not about the process, but the spreadsheet itself. So I guess that's all I have. If there is nothing else, I would entertain a motion
to adjourn.
Second. To adjourn. We have a motion and a second. Seeing no comments. Oh.
No,
thank you. Thank you very much. Next meeting is August the 9th.
Thank you all. Enjoy the beautiful weekend.
Actually, that would be my father's 100th birthday.